The world's leading climate scientists and authors of a report by the UN Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, that is IPCC, have warned that we, the inhabitants of planet Earth, have only 12 years for global warming to be kept to a maximum of 1.5 degrees Celsius, beyond which even half a degree will significantly worsen the risks of drought, floods, extreme heat, and poverty for hundreds of millions of people. How can half a degree of extra global warming be make or break for the future of our planet? And will developing countries like India pay a bigger price for not containing global warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius rise in temperatures? That's the focus of Urban Reality today. I'm Anisha Natarajan, and joining me on the discussion is Aruma Revi, Director of the Indian Institute for Human Settlements and the coordinating lead author of the IPCC's report. Also with us, Chaitanya Kalia, Partner Advisory Services, EY India. With me in the Delhi studio, Lydia Powell, Distinguished Fellow and Head ORF Center for Resources Management, and Mr. Jay Srinivasan, Distinguished Scientist at IISc. I'm going to try and decode the findings of this IPCC report, which rings in serious alarm bells, in fairly simple language so everyone who's watching gets it on why global warming is an immediate problem and not someone else's problem. Aruma Revi, first question to you. The report says limiting global warming to a rise of 1.5 degrees Celsius is critical, and if it shoots to 2 degrees, it could have disastrous consequences. Can you elaborate how and how did scientists arrive at this conclusion?
Well, we've been saying this for many years from the IPCC. When I led the chapter that looked at this question on urban areas for the last assessment, which was published in 2014, we said this would be a very serious challenge, especially for urban areas across the planet. So this is based on an assessment. This particular report looked at about 6,000 new pieces of scientific literature over the last 3 years. So it is probably one of the most significant pieces of science that's been done in the recent past. And it examines all sectors. It examines the entire economy. It examines agriculture. It examines cities. It examines the energy system, which is centrally part of it. But the most important thing is that this is, I guess, a rude awakening or a wake-up call that we actually have a very limited period of time to make this transition. Like we said, we're at 1 degree at the moment. 2017 was when we breached the 1 degree over pre-industrial. We're growing at about 0.2 degrees per decade at the current rate of emissions, which basically means that by the late 2030s, if we don't really move very quickly, we are going to breach the 1.5 degree burden. And two, of course, like the IPCC has been saying for a long period of time, is very serious. So, you know, if you connect the dots over the last few years in India, connect up the dots between Srinagar, between Kedarnath, Chennai, Kochi, and of course, drought in many places, we're going to be seeing at two all of those things in a sense happening pretty much every week. I mean, to give you a broad sense of the kind of thing. So it's going to be significant. But the nice and the positive thing the report says is that we actually know how to do this. You know, I spent a fair amount of time with almost 50 authors from across the world trying to assess what the options were to make the change. And there are lots of things that we can do. But the thing, of course, is that we have to start now. And we don't have the time that we had earlier of doing things in a piecemeal manner.
Okay.
We have to do all of these changes together.
Okay.
Transform the energy system, transform our agriculture and our urban systems together.
All right. Mr. Revi, break down the disastrous consequences for us. Yes, you've said Kedarnath, you've said Kashmir, we've seen what happened in Uttarakhand. But somehow, you know, just looking at the environmental disasters which happen, people are not waking up and smelling the coffee. Okay, there will be sea level rise. Something that resonates very strongly with a developing country like India is that it will actually increase global poverty. Can you tell us what the relation is?
Well, it's a question of the choices that we make. In fact, in this report, what we are saying is that we have very good evidence about how we can actually bring good development and climate action together. So, for example, as far as India is concerned, I would say one of the first priorities for us is to try and end energy poverty. which means that, you know, every person in this country should have access to good, clean, renewable power, and at least, you know, an LED light bulb at the end of the, you know, at the end of that lead. That will immediately change the opportunities for us. And the critical thing is we need to create employment. So this transition that we're seeing, which in some senses has been 150 years in the making, where, you know, we're seeing this is the beginning of the end of the oil and gas and potentially the coal industry, which has driven 150 years of development. And that is being taken over very rapidly, including in India, by the rollout of renewable energy. Many technical problems that are there in trying to make this happen. But this is going to sort of, in a sense, create tremendous new economic opportunities for us.
Mr. Srinivasan, I'd like to bring you in here. Now, 15 African and Asian countries, they say, are highly vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And amongst the least ready to respond to its impact, India has been named as one. As a distinguished scientist who follows this through very, very closely, we've taken the lead as a country when it comes to climate change. Then why are we so unprepared, sir?
Yeah, you must remember that as far as India is concerned, we are not the major contributor to CO2 emission. We contribute just 6%. So what we do or don't do about coal or oil is not going to change the global mean temperature. But we are going to be affected by the temperature change. So we need to learn how to adapt to these storms and heat waves and droughts. So for that, I think this is a good warning that more of these unfortunate events are going to take place and we have to learn how to adapt to it. But as regards reducing the CO2 emission, we need to do that in the long term, not in the short term, because we should not go the way China went, building a large number of coal power plants. That we need to stop. But at this stage, I think the major role to mitigate global warming has to be taken by USA, China, and Europe, because they contribute the largest amount of CO2 emission.
Okay.
And it's not India which is doing that.
Chaitanya Kalia, yeah. Let's come to the economics of it all. I mean, how much will it cost nations to bring about the change? I mean, there's also the question of developed countries, which Mr. Srinivasan has already named, having already contributed to tremendous amount of global warming and greenhouse emissions. They were meant to bring in money, technology to developing countries to help them align themselves to reducing emissions. But that's not happening, is it?
That's right. It's not happening the way it was expected from the industry, and it's going to cost quite a lot. Thankfully, the growth in our service sector is generally high as compared to the manufacturing, and our policies in India are more aligned now towards promoting renewable, and service sector mostly need energy in form of electricity, and that can be supplied through renewable energy. So there is some balancing approach as I see going forward. Otherwise, just shifting from coal to any other form of fuel and the technology, which probably even we don't have. So put together all of that, it's going to cost quite a lot. And it makes industry very uncomfortable from that sense. Mm. They understand the responsibility, but how to go about it, that pathway is not very clear, I must say.
Industries understand their responsibilities, Lydia Powell, is that so?
The IPCC report in a way acknowledges that fossil fuels, including coal, cannot be phased away. It introduces carbon capture and storage, which are mainly used for coal, oil and gas, to capture the carbon that they emit and put it underground. So it actually endorses that technique. It also endorses, because there is limited time, as the previous speaker said, it also endorses another idea which has been unpopular, which is used to be known as geoengineering, but in the report it refers to it as carbon dioxide reduction. That means carbon dioxide is going to be sucked out of the atmosphere and stored in underground. So I feel these two ideas being incorporated in the report shows that renewable energy alone cannot
so that is
carbon.
Not a wrong premise to make. So the report also examines, in some of it that you mentioned, pathways available to limit warming to 1.5 degrees Celsius. What would it take to achieve those is my question to you, and what would the consequences be?
I think this report also acknowledges that there's a lot of societal change that would be required. Previous reports were excessively...
Elaborate for us. Break it down for our viewers. Yeah. When you say societal change, people don't get it. What is societal change?
A lot of choices have to be made, some of them very difficult. We are used to a very high-energy lifestyle, transport, comfort, and so on. So you might have to compromise. You might have to choose the time at which you use energy, and so on. So these are choices that the consumers will have to make. And very often, even in this IPCC report, the choices that the society and the consumers have to make is not elaborated. The assumption is that at the supply end, substitution can be made, and society can live as they have for all these years. I think that is an idea which needs to be elaborated.
Okay. Why don't you break down? I mean, for a country like India, the kind of environment we live in, what are some of the choices we can make which we can implement right away in our lives?
Well, I think the thing about India is our per capita emissions, like Professor Srinivasan said, are relatively low. And we have to adapt. But there are lots of little things that we can do. I mean, you know, water, for example, is a very scarce resource in this country, both in cities and in agriculture. We have to implement, considerable water efficiencies. We can do that. That's good for the farmers. That's good for, you know, risk in terms of agriculture. But for that, we have to actually change the relationship between, let's say, free power and the availability of water. We have to conserve both, groundwater and surface water. Similarly, it's now become quite cost-effective for people to start shifting to solar PV-based production on homes. We've seen a revolution in that happening in many parts of the world, including places like Germany and now increasingly in China. But I think as far as, our living environments are concerned for middle-class people, it means cities that function much better. It means having public transportation, which was the way that we actually used to move a few years ago, becoming the most significant source of mobility in cities. It means electrifying our transport in a few years. Again, China is doing this very dramatically at the current point of time, which will mean, better living conditions, less air pollution, and much less health expenditure. So these are win-win things that are there. Of course, the summary doesn't deal with this in some detail, but the underlying report, which is quite extensive, deals with all of these questions and sort of breaks them down. So, for those of you who have the time and energy, I would encourage you to go in and look at that in much more detail.
All right. Well, we'll keep the discussion going. After a very short break, we're going to focus on the politics of it all. Look at it. I mean, if you look at the historic record, developed nations have the highest responsibility. Since industrial times, the figure is very interesting. United States is reported for 28% of the carbon that is in the atmosphere right now. India, less than 6%. And therefore, India stand that those countries which have the biggest historic carbon footprint should pay more. Is that valid or not? Let's come back and talk more about that.